During our journey through the representations of the canonical commutation relations, we have seen that there is a big difference between the case of a finite number of degrees of freedom and infinite case. In the case of a finite number, we have this Stone von Neumann uniqueness theorem, which tells us that all irreducible representations are unitarily equivalent, but in the case of infinite number of degrees of freedom, this breaks totally down. And this is somehow the motivation that we should shift our emphasis from concrete representations on a Hilbert space maybe to more an algebraic point of view. And last time I told you that we should consider the algebra and then as the primary object and then look for representations. But of course we should also not just stay on a very algebraic level, but we should look for the C-star algebras, because this means that we want to realize our algebra always as operators on a Hilbert space. And so in the last chapter of this lecture series, I want to make this more precise and really talk about what is the C-star algebra which we should consider. And this is the CCR algebra. But a C-star algebra given by the Weyl relations. So this chapter is about the CCR algebra. But with this we mean not just an algebraic object, but we really mean an algebra with more analytic properties, so namely a C-star algebra. And this is generated by the Weyl relations. So let me be more precise. So what do I mean with this? And maybe first let us recall our setting for the realization of the canonical commutation relations. So of course, so we have a Hilbert space. So this is the realization on the bosonic Fock space. We start with a Hilbert space, then we build a corresponding symmetric Fock space. I denoted this by F plus of H. So this is the direct sum of tensor powers of H, but divided by the relation that we only consider symmetric tensors. So this guy here is the corresponding symmetric or bosonic Fock space, and on this we had creation and annihilation operators, which we denoted by A plus and A, and they depend on elements, vectors from the underlying Hilbert space. So I have A plus of F for each F, so these are creation operators, and we have A of F, these are annihilation operators. And they are defined for all f's in my underlying Hilbert space. And this guy here is the adjoint of this. So I could also write it as AF F star. But of course they are unbounded operators. And and so what we consider now, those guys, they of course are not, each of them are not self-adjoint, but if we take their sum, because they are adjoints of each other, they are self-adjoint. And that's the operators in which we are really interested in, because we need self-adjoint operators. So then we define, let me denote it here by phi of f, so for each f, I can take the sum of the corresponding creation and annihilation operator, and let me normalize it by a square root of 2. So it's A plus of F plus A of F. So this is a self-adjoint operator, but of course the operators are unbounded, so this is also an unbounded operator, but it is essentially self-adjoint. If, of course, we have to provide their domains, but if we take the canonical domains, then those are essentially self-adjoint operators. So they are essentially self-adjoint. So those are good operators. But they are still unbounded. And in order not to have to deal with the pathologies for unbounded operators, we go over to the unitary groups which they generate. We go over to the bounded operators, which by functional calculus contain the same information as those operators. So the objects we really investigate are then the unitary groups generated by those. So W of F will be E to the I phi F. Okay, and we know how to define this by functional calculus for self-adjoint operators. And maybe you might wonder, so this is our reformulation of the canonical commutation relations. And for the canonical commutation relations, usually one has the P's and the Q's. One was the sum of creation and annihilation operator, and one was the difference. So you might wonder whether I'm not missing here the ones with the minus. But you should notice that if I define those guys here for all F's, then actually this is included, because whereas the annihilation is linear in its argument, this guy here is antilinear, which means by choosing multiples with I of the F, I also get the corresponding minus. So before we only considered those guys where the F was running through a basis, and then I took both, I had to take the sum and the difference, but if I allow this for all F, then this is here included. So we should note, just to see that I'm not missing here something, that if I consider the creation operator in its argument, then it's linear. Just look on the definition, then this is clear. So linear in particular, if I multiply here with a complex number, this complex number comes out here. And if I consider the corresponding annihilation operator, A of F, then this is, in its argument, it's antilinear. Of course, A of the sum of two is the sum of the two A's, but if I multiply this with a complex number, then the complex conjugate comes out. Just look how this acts, because this acts by taking the inner product of F with the guys on which it's act. But the F is in the it's the first argument in the inner product, and the inner product is antilinear in this guy. So this guy here is antilinear. And this means that if I consider, or if I replace F by I times F, then I have phi of IF. Then this is 1 over the square root of 2 of A plus of IF. I can take any argument here, plus A of IF. But now here, the I comes out as an I, but here it comes out as a minus I. And so what I have here is now really it's 1 over 2 square root of 2 times I, and here I have A plus of F minus A of F. So you see that if I let run F over all possibilities here, I capture here the plus and the minus. So I have the position and the momentum operators subsumed under this general definition. Good, okay, so this means this this guy here encodes both the P and the Q. And so if I take the W of F, these while operators, they encode both the unitary groups of the P and the unitary groups of the Q. Those were the guys which we called U and V. And what I call here W is also more or less the same as what we called W back then when we proved the Stone von Neumann uniqueness theorem. And so this means what I have here, I have encoded all my information now in these operators here, and they satisfy, of course, some relations, the while relations, and that's the relations which we want to understand and for which we want to look for representations. So the while operators, these W's, while operators, W of F, they satisfy a couple of relations. Maybe first trivial one, of course, F of 0. If I plug in F is equal to 0, then of course the phi is just the 0 operator. and then e to the 0 is equal to 1. So this is just the identity operator. Then of course each, because those guys are self-adjoint, e to this guy, this is a unitary operator. So for each f, I have a unitary operator. This is unitary. And then maybe also let us see what happens if I take the w of f star. So if I take the w of f star, then I'm getting here. So this is self-adjoint, nothing happens here, but the I is getting replaced by minus I, and then I get a minus which can get in here, so this is W of minus F. So taking the star can also be achieved by just looking on a different argument. And of course this is compatible, this relation is compatible with the fact that this is unitary, and I get this relation. And maybe, okay, maybe I also need for this the last one, which is the most important. Of course, the point is now, what is the commutation relation between two of those W? So what happens if I multiply W of F times W of G? This, of course, this commutes with some factor, but actually it turns out that this is also again a W, but of the argument F plus G, times some phase factor, which is e to the minus I over 2. And I take the imaginary part of f comma g. So maybe you should check this in this language. We observed this essentially when we talked about the proof of the Stone von Neumann uniqueness theorem, and maybe even if we didn't write it in this form, in one of the assignments we really wrote it in terms of the imaginary part. So because there we had real parameters s and t for indexing our arguments, but in one assignment we looked on replacing s and t by the complex number s plus it, and in terms of this we had exactly this formula. So this is easy to see, so maybe you should check it if you don't believe it or if you don't remember, so that we have for all f and g in our Hilbert space this relation. So if I multiply two of those Weyl operators, I get a Weyl operator at the argument which is the sum, and I get a phase factor which is given by this imaginary part. Okay, and very often, so this here is the crucial quantity which we use from our underlying Hilbert space in those relations, this actually is very often denoted by sigma f comma g, and this is a symplectic form, which means if I'm exchanging f and g, I get a minus sign. If I exchange here f and g, then I get the complex conjugate of this inner product, but the imaginary part of the complex conjugate just gives me a minus sign. So this is minus sigma g comma f. So this is a symplectic form. But given concretely as the imaginary part of our inner product. Good, okay, and so those relations here encode now the canonical commutation relations in the form of the Weyl relations. And those are the guys which we want to understand, those relations. And as we have seen, at least in a case where the underlying Hilbert space is infinite dimensional, then there is no uniqueness for the irreducible representation for this relation. And this gave us the idea, this motivated what I said last time, that somehow we should divide the investigation of those relations into maybe more an algebraic part, looking on the algebra, which maybe should correspond to the general properties of our quantum field theories, if we want to describe some physics, and then looking on representations of this algebra, which corresponds to properties for specific theories. But this means a very high level. Consequence is we should look on those relations from algebraic point of view, try to understand as much as possible on this algebraic level, and then if we want to do concrete physics, maybe look for representations. Good. Okay, but I also already mentioned, that actually it's not really just the algebra in which we are interested, because we want those operators here, those while operators, if we realize them, we always do it on a Hilbert space. Huh? I mean, quantum mechanics lives on a Hilbert space. Yeah? So those guys should really be operators on a Hilbert space. Huh? So it's not just the algebra generated by those guys, which is interesting, but it's actually the C-star algebra. So the C-star algebra is the analytic object which tells us that we are looking on those W's just from the point of view that they always should be realized, or that they are given by bounded operators on a Hilbert space. Yeah, okay, and so that's maybe what we want to understand a little bit in the following. So we are going to define the CCR algebra as the C-star algebra generated by those relations, and for this it's crucial to understand how much of the analytic structure is really determined by the relations.